Pleased to be joined by the mayor of the city of Baltimore, Brandon Scott, joins us this morning. Good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Hey, Mr. Mayor.
I know he's there. Mayor Brandon Scott?
Yeah, good morning, gentlemen. Good morning.
There we go. I thought you were there. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor, for joining our show. Look, there's a lot of political things in the air to get to, but I have to start with this because I understand the significance of what we are watching when it comes to violent crime. I went back, Mr. Mayor, and looked at the beginning of April, April 1st. Thank you for your police department media who sent the daily numbers for homicides and non-fatal shootings to all of us. But it was 48 was the number of homicides on April the 1st of last month. Today, or yesterday, May the 1st, is 59. 11 homicides in 1 month. Non-fatal shootings, there were 144 so far this year compared to 190 last year. I mean, these numbers are just significant, Mayor Scott.
They are. And see, for as I said yesterday, that number of 11, while still 11 too many, is the lowest one-month number that we've had since 2015, which was February of 2015, to be exact. That is not something for us to squawk at and realize that we had a historic reduction of 20% last year, and we have a 33% reduction on top of that. And there are not many months on record, really,
right,
recently that beat that number. When you think about what we had even in 2011, there are just a few months. And I think that we cannot allow the significance of the progress being made on the streets of Baltimore to be poo-pooed at. Because we were talking about months when the three of us were talking a few years ago, and after the unrest, we were talking about months.
We had 11 in one week, let alone 30, a month.
35, 40, and that's significant progress. And I think when you think about, and also how we're doing it matters, right, that we're focused in on those groups. We're giving people opportunities. We're focusing on the guns. We're focusing in on the organizations. We're focused on every part and really doing it the right way with so many partners. I was at the We Are Us breakfast on Tuesday morning talking about how we're all working together. Police, community, government, other community partners like our hospital partners, everybody working together to do this, and we can see that we can do it and be better. So now we just have to work to be our best, and that's ultimately what we want for us as a city.
So is there a reason in your mind why or how it happened so quickly? Because it was, you know, less than a year ago where we were still pretty high numbers. And I know you had this as your goal to be down, I think 15% is what you said every single year when you were first elected. But it has happened rather quickly. What's the reasoning behind the quickness of it?
Well, Brian, I think that this is called what it looks like when you have sustained results, right? Because, you know, we had the first year, and you two are the first to say it, that it didn't just start in 2023, the reduction. It started in September of 2022 when we started to see the violence go down. And it's a sustained reduction because, unlike in the past, we have a plan, a comprehensive plan that encompasses everything, and everyone sticks to that plan. When you think about folks say, like, oh, well, the mayor didn't, why is homicides dropping in the Eastern District and GVRS isn't there? But you say that GVRS is helping to drive, to reduce the violence in the city. Well, the truth is that now Colonel Thacker, when he was the Major Thacker in the Eastern District, he incorporated the shooting reviews and all the other things and the focus portions of it before even having GVRS in there. This is about sustainable results. When you have a 20% reduction, Brian, you can then build on that the next year. And that's what we're doing each and every day. This is about how we build the infrastructure, the plan, the strategy that we can sustain over time. And that's what I think is important for the residents of Baltimore to know, to your listeners throughout the region to know, that we're building it that can be sustained. Not we go out and rush and do one thing and then go back to doing the original thing you were doing, and it raises back up. We have to adjust. We have to stay focused and keep that core premise of the of what we said we would do and how we would do it.
The mayor of the city of Baltimore, Brandon Scott, is on board with us. And Mayor, while those numbers are just, you know, really eye-popping in terms of homicides and non-fatal shootings, we got to talk about the issue of juveniles, because we just had two 13-year-olds who were arrested in a stolen car. They've been riding around for a few days that they were arrested by Baltimore City Police. We had a group of 10 to 15 juveniles jump a man and woman right at Light and Conway. One of them arrested was 14 years old. So while, you know, it's not the same as shootings, but it's still we have these juveniles doing this.
Yes, sir. And listen, and I think that C4, there's a lot of talk about us not being even focused there. And you guys know this, but I want to make sure that your viewers know this, right? That when you look at the things that are happening, even from a stolen auto and other points, we're starting to see progress there as well, right? When you look at the last 28-day period, you're talking about a 20% reduction in auto theft. Carjackings, which were, as you know, were already down 15% last year, are down an additional 12% and are down an additional 56% in the 28-day period. BPD is focused on all of these things. And when you know and I know that what they have to be doing is making sure that they're making the arrest on these individuals and catching them, already in 2024, they've already arrested over 200 people for stolen auto, 165 adults, 45 juveniles. Last year, they made 786 arrests for stolen autos, 515 adults, 271 juveniles, right? Robbery, the same thing. They're going to continue to do that work. We're also working in deeper partnership with our partners at the state to uplift and highlight, like, hey, we can't continue to see these young people, and we're making progress in partnership with those folks, and we're looking forward to deepening that so that we're holding people accountable. And I believe that part of the reason why we've seen those numbers start to move in the right direction is because they're starting to see that there's accountability on the other side.
Let's talk a little bit about the palace drama, because, you know, that's what a lot of people want to know, what's going on. Tharu Vignaraja dropped out of the race yesterday. He threw his support behind Sheila Dixon. You said that Tharu Vignaraja came to you. When did he come to you, and what exactly did he ask of you in order to get your support or for him to get on with you?
What I said yesterday is the truth. He reached out. I wanted to meet in person, man to man, because I respect him and everyone else in this race to have any kind of conversation like that in person. He originally said he was interested in being the police commissioner, but yesterday he was focused on the CEO of public schools. I don't think that's a role for him. I told him that. I told him that he obviously has been a public servant in the public safety realm and that he has served there, but I don't think that's the role for him, and said that, you know, seeing that, knowing that is what he wanted, that I thought he should stay in the race. That's it. It's that simple.
Well, in that case, considering the fact that now he's thrown his support behind Sheila Dixon, are you making, you know, an effort to go after his voters and kind of where they are as opposed to getting his support?
Well, yeah, of course. We're going after everybody's voters, C4, and we're going to continue to do that. We're going to continue to tell the story of what Baltimore was when I took office and what progress we've made and what progress we know that we still have to make. And I think that's important for everyone to remember. When I took office, we didn't know what the next 2 weeks were going to look like, right? The city, the world was basically being locked down. We had homicides stuck at above 300 for many, many years. We had an unemployment rate of 9. We've been able to make significant historic progress in reducing violence in the city of Baltimore. Unemployment hit its lowest level ever last year. We have the 8th fastest growing economy. Why now, when Baltimore's finally breaking away from all the failed turmoil and leadership of the past, finally making headway on violence, which has been the number one issue in every mayor election in my lifetime, with the exception of this one, why would we now turn back or change course now?
Okay, having said that, you've got the two elected officials who, you know, are in public safety, in the state's attorney, Ivan Bates, and Sam Cogan, the sheriff, who have endorsed Sheila Dixon as well and saying that they need a better partner. Yesterday, Sam Cogan was on our show, and he said one of the big issues that he has with you is that he implored you to help him pay his deputies more, and that he just wanted to move money around to pay his deputies more, and that you blocked it, that you did not allow that to happen. your response to that? Did that happen? How do you see it in your eyes?
Yeah, and I think that this is the difference between me and the sheriff. I don't play politics of public safety. Bryan, if you or anyone else, I think we're all smarter to believe that this issue with the sheriff happened many, many, many months ago, but not until the week before early voting does he say something about it. We're smarter than that. This is all politics, but this is the truth. The sheriff, unfortunately, sometimes thinks he can just do what he wants. He wanted to, quote unquote, move money around and do all of these things. I, of course, believe in collective bargaining and making sure that the labor union, the bargaining unit, understand is want and wants to have those things work in that way. So as a leader who is respected by labor unions, including his, I made a call. I asked directly to the union, the FOP that represents the sheriff, did they know about what the sheriff was trying to do, and is this the way they wanted to do it? They flat out said no. They wanted to be collectively bargained, and I put them on a meeting with me and the sheriff and his representatives and said that they had my word that if a bill is introduced to solely a bill focused around the sheriff's department and allowing them to collectively bargain their wages in Annapolis, that the mayor would be there to testify in support. That's the truth of the matter.
So are you saying that he was trying to, like, break up the union and he was just trying to...
No, I'm saying that he was going around the union without communicating with them and not informing them of what he was doing, and knows that that's not the way that the people were elected by his workers want this thing to happen. And we're not even going to get into the details of what he said, but that is what happened, and that's the truth. And I look forward to working with him and the bargaining unit next year in Annapolis to solve the issue regardless, because I don't play politics with public safety, whether other people do or not.
When it comes to, you just mentioned
and
it.
Then, sorry.
Go ahead.
Sorry,
go ahead. Go ahead, Mayor.
And then I would mention, just because this is a drum that they're trying to beat, Bryan, the number one highest ranked public law enforcement official in the state of Maryland has endorsed my campaign and said that I'm a deep partner. Our U.S. senators have endorsed my campaign and said I'm a deep partner. You saw me stand up last week with Governor Bob Ehrlich, Senator Kathleen Sulega, who I don't agree with basically anything on outside of what we're doing with the Key Bridge, and Republicans from all over the state last week. We're talking about working in partnership. This is just simply not true.
So why do you think this happening? Why do you think? Do you feel like you're being
politics.
Ganged up?
It's politics.
Well, they're elected officials. I mean, they're elected officials. They have jobs. I mean, they don't necessarily need to. You know.
I hear you, but this is politics, and I don't play politics with public safety, Bryan, period. You all know that I worked with Governor Hogan. It doesn't matter to me when it comes to public safety who it is. We'll work with the person there in the job and do it the right way and not play politics with the most important responsibility of any elected official, any government, and that's to keep people safe.
You mentioned this yesterday, but I wanted to come back to it, Mr. Mayor. When it comes to what we're watching on college campuses all over the country right now, whether it's Mayor Karen Bass in L.A. or Mayor Muriel Bowser right down the road, Mayor Eric Adams in New York, they've had to make these decisions to have law enforcement help on these college campuses. Johns Hopkins University is facing this right now. What communication have you had with President Daniels and Johns Hopkins about the role that the city police would play if they were called in?
Yeah, I'll reiterate what I said and what we said to them and what we said publicly in a statement, right? We're monitoring the situation. We're in constant contact with university officials, and we will continue to do that. We've been communicated to them that we stand with people's right to protest, but we also have a responsibility to deal with public safety. And when we see credible threat of violence or assembly, a high threshold to protect the general public safety, BPD, that's when we would have BPD. But until that point, we have no plans right now to engage solely to shut down a peaceful protest. As you know, we don't do that in Baltimore.
I understand, Mr. But one of the concerns the other mayors have had, and that's why I wanted to raise it with you, is that a lot of these folks on campus aren't students. Like, these movements have now been entered into by outside adults and that type of drive. Just your thoughts about that part, because other mayors have said the same thing I'm saying about what's going on in their campuses.
Yeah, listen, we all know that anytime you have large protests, that has a potential to happen, right? We saw it in Freddie Gray. We saw it even in George Floyd, right? I saw it myself when folks would enter themselves into the 300-man march, right? And that's why you have to have the constant communication. That's why you have to have people on the ground to make sure that you can deal with anything as they're arising in the moment. And that's why we're going to continue to do that and do everything with in accordance with the Constitution to make sure that we're protecting people's right to peacefully protest. But again, we will not stand by and let public safety be threatened. We've had a lot of experience over the years of allowing peaceful protests to go on and protecting people's rights, but not allowing things to escalate because we've seen firsthand what that could do in our city.
What do you think in general about what we're seeing on college campuses? Have they gone too far in your mind, and should police have been brought in certain cases like Columbia?
Well, listen, we know that when you see stuff escalate to high levels and people's public safety is at risk, that's one thing. But I think that we have to, every single city, every single college situation is going to be different, Bryan, right? I can't put myself in my counterpart's shoes because I'm not them. And they can't put themselves in my shoes because what's happening here is different from what's happening there. And I think that anybody that's Monday morning quarterbacking a decision of a mayor has to understand the weight that person has on them and how they have to look at a much larger picture than most people.
All right, but if Hopkins called and said, listen, this tent city's been up for too long and there's no way we can get them out unless we bring them out with police force, is that enough for you to say yes, that the Baltimore Police Department should be used in just dispersing the tent city that has been set up?
So, Bryan, we already have policies for how we deal with encampments in the city. We do that with Homeland Services and BPD consistently. We, again, will be working with our partners at Hopkins on any efforts to deal with the protest, period. And that, of course, will evolve as we go through the protest, and that is not a cookie-cutter thing. It has to deal with the situation on the ground. We have some of the best law enforcement folks that around, right, not just in the police commission and his team, but the deputy mayor, who have the experience of dealing with these situations and know that you can't make blanket statements about how to deal with something like this. You have to deal with it from the realities of what's existing right there in the moment.
Mayor Brandon Scott, as always, we appreciate your time. And 2 weeks to go. Early voting starts today, so 2 weeks to go.
How are you feeling, Mr. Mayor? How are you feeling about your chances?
I'm feeling good. Listen, when what you do in C4 knows this. You run your race, you tell the truth, you stand on the work that you've done, and I can stand on a heck of a record, leading us through a global pandemic with a city fair better than most cities, doing what we said we would do and what the voters sent me there to do, and reduce violent crime, and did that in a historic way, bringing unemployment down to its lowest point, having one of the fastest growing economies in the country, vacant housing is at its lowest point in 20 years, dealing with the squeegee issue, significantly reducing that, opening more schools than any mayor in the history of the city, reopening rec centers. We have a lot to stand on, and now it's up to the voters, and I believe they will reelect me.
Have a great day, Mayor Brandon Scott. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.